Hi everyone, my name is Meher Sindhu Batra and I'm back with another video. Today's video is a very, very special interview because it's for all those aspiring law students out there. I will be interviewing my cousin Ishmeet Kaur, who is born and raised in New Delhi. She pursued her undergraduate degree from Lady Sriram College, Delhi University. Post that, she pursued her law degree from Faculty of Law, Delhi University. After that, she went on to do her LLM from Cambridge University in the UK at full scholarship. She's worked at top firms like Amarchand in India, and now she works as a disputes lawyer in London. Please welcome Ishmeet.
Hi,
Ishmeet. Thank you for coming in for an interview. It's such a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you for inviting me, and I can't wait to speak to you and all your students out there.
So I think any advice that you give to these young, confused professionals will be really, really helpful. So thank you so much. And I actually asked them for a bunch of questions that they have sent across for me to ask you. So Ishmeet, why don't we start from the very beginning? Why don't you tell us about your childhood, your upbringing and your school life?
So I was actually raised in New Delhi and I did my schooling from Modern School, Vasant Vihar. When I was in 11th standard, I chose the commerce stream. To be very honest, I was not sure whether that was the right decision for me at the time, but I'm glad I did it, and gave me some analytical skills at the time, which have been pretty helpful. I was a very, very talented in the sense that I would do a lot of, be involved in a lot of extracurricular activities in school, whether it was debating, dance, sports. I went on to be a national level athlete also in school. So all of these things really helped me in nurturing and kind of cultivating soft skills that have helped me in my professional life as well as my personal life.
That's wonderful. So you were like an all-rounder.
I don't want to say I was an all-rounder, but I was definitely more drawn to extracurriculars than academics. And probably that was the reason, and that was probably the key thing that actually helped me become the head girl of the school in my final year. Because there was a function I still remember in school where I was also comparing, I was also dancing for it. I was involved in every aspect of school life, and I'm very, very glad I was. I wasn't someone who always studied. I wasn't someone who you'd see with books all the time. In fact, after school, I always had classes after classes, whether it was painting class, whether it was music class, whether it was debating, public speaking, whether it was sports training. And that kind of gave me a very all-rounded and a very, very holistic view of life in general and all the attributes that one must hone and skills one must hone in life.
Wonderful, wonderful. That's such a nice thing to think about. You know, when you think about your school life, it's a lot of ups and downs, but it's nice to think about your achievements. So tell us a little bit about, you know, the boards that one has to give in the 12th grade. How did you face them? Were they difficult for you? Were they easy? What were you feeling at that time?
Oh God, when I think about boards, I shudder at the thought. I wasn't someone who got 90% in the board exams. I didn't even get late 80s. I was someone who got 80%. And at that point of time, believe me, I thought my life was over and that I would not be able to do anything in life. It was definitely a very, very challenging time. As I said earlier, I wasn't sure whether commerce was the right choice for me. But you know how you follow the herd? And I did follow the herd, and I took up commerce and I studied that. And even though I'm very appreciative of the skills it gave me, I don't necessarily think that it was the right thing for me. But I would say that even though I didn't get a 95% in boards and I thought my world's come to an end, it really doesn't matter. Those were learnings that have helped me grow in life. Those were obstacles. And I think what's the most important thing in life is resilience, that you can get up after you've fallen down. So I think that was the most important thing for me through this whole board experience, and it's actually an experience I treasure now. At the time it made me cry, but today I look at it with a very, very fond memory.
Wow, that's so important to reflect on. I think a lot of young students who may be thinking that, okay, I haven't scored well in my board exams and nothing is going to happen in my life, nothing good is going to happen. And I think Ishmeet is just trying to tell you that anything is possible, and your board exams are just like 0.01% of your entire career journey. So then after that, Ishmeet, what was the next step? Like applying to colleges, universities, what was going through your mind at that time?
Honestly, it was such a difficult time for me. I remember seeing all the cutoff lists that came out and they said 98%, 99%. And I remember seeing online on and as well as on news and people were getting 100% marks and I was here with an 80% going to these colleges and requesting for a seat. As I mentioned earlier, I was into sports and a lot of extracurriculars, and actually that is the thing that helped me secure admission in Delhi University. So I actually applied through sports quotas at different universities. I applied through the public speaking quota, and I was fortunate to actually have received offers from JMC, from Hansraj, from Gargi, and from LSR, all for different courses ranging from political science to sociology to philosophy to BA program.
So then how did you decide on Lady Shri Ram College, and what was the course that you finally pursued?
So I actually applied to LSR through the public speaking and extracurricular quota. I had a series of auditions, and after the auditions I actually got offered a seat, but I wasn't sure on what course, and they also gave me offers of different humanities arts courses, which was sociology, philosophy and history at the time. So because I was a commerce student, I wasn't sure if I'll be able to actually understand humanities courses such as political science and history. At that point of time, I had no idea what philosophy was all about, and I actually ended up taking philosophy. And at that time, I was also confused whether I want to study an undergraduate degree at all, or do I want to pursue something else, maybe do a law degree the following year, take the CLAT exam. But I ended up anyway securing my seat at Lady Shri Ram in the philosophy division.
So how was your experience at Lady Shri Ram College? How was your college life?
So earlier I thought that I'll only do it for a year, and maybe I'll take the law entrance exam the following year, or maybe some other entrance exams, or take up a professional degree. And I went into the course with a little bit of a closed mind, but I'm actually very, very grateful to my family and my dad in particular, who kept telling me to have an open mind, and he's made me speak to a lot of people who had studied philosophy or who were even teaching philosophy, and they had such wonderful things to say about the subject that I think the best decision I made in life, when I look back in hindsight, when I look back at my life, it was studying philosophy. It actually got me to think differently. It got me engaged in academics. It actually also got me very, very interested in reading about different thinkers, different scholars. And I didn't know an aspect of me which was to read so much and get so involved in academics, which was something I never got to experience in school, but I actually got to experience and love at Lady Shri Ram.
That's so wonderful that you know you reached out to these mentors who had done that same degree, and it's important to get that their feedback.
Absolutely.
And implement that.
Absolutely. It's so important when you're unsure about what you want to do in life, and or if you're not sure where your life's headed, to seek that reassurance. That reassurance can just be a pact or something that can just make you feel confident when you take a decision or whatever journey or road that you are embarking on. And it is important to seek that help, and you should never ever feel shy or feel afraid to reach out to people who could be in a better position to help you.
And then how did you like stumble upon law? Was that always on your mind when you started philosophy, or was that something you discovered later?
So actually it's really funny. I always thought that there was a part of me that was meant to be in a profession that had to do with public speaking. So at that time when I was in school, everyone used to joke around saying, "You argue so much, Ashmeet, you should be a lawyer." I dabbled with the idea of it in school, but never really pursued it. And it was only when I was in Lady Shri Ram and I was seeing all my friends around me, you know, figure out what next, whether it was sitting for placements or whether it was applying for master's courses abroad as well as in India, or doing a master's in philosophy itself. I, at that point of time, thought of all the colleges that offered a three-year law degree in India, and I started actually studying for the law faculty entrance exam.
So you started studying in second year?
So I actually started studying for the entrance in my final year of Lady Shri Ram, and it actually was a little bit challenging because final year is also a very tough year in terms of sitting for placements, in terms of also if there are any of your friends who are applying for master's degrees, you're always tempted to even look at those options. So I think it's very important to stay focused and not get into the rut of getting into too many things and getting very, very distracted by all the options out there. we are spoiled for choice, but it's always better to be focused on what it is that you want to do next.
Wonderful. So how was your experience in studying for these law entrances?
So actually, not many people I think know that there are a number of universities and colleges in India that offer the 3-year law degree. In Maharashtra, there are a couple, but for those, you need to have a good undergraduate degree to pursue the LLB degree, which is, even though an undergraduate degree, it is treated as a postgraduate because you can only study or apply for it after you've completed your first undergraduation degree. So there's also private universities like Jindal that offer the 3-year law degree. I was sure I wanted to do my law degree from Delhi University Faculty of Law, and it is an entrance exam that takes place in the summer. It requires a knowledge of general knowledge, basic legal principles, logical reasoning. Things that you study for the CLAT exam are actually very, very helpful for the Faculty of Law exam. So a lot of the colleges that offer the 3-year LLB degree have a criteria of a good undergraduate score. So if you've done really well in your first undergraduate degree, you can actually secure admission in one of the other universities, such as those in Maharashtra. And I had done really well in my undergraduate degree, so I applied to those as well, and I was able to secure admission. But law faculty is considered to be one of the best for the 3-year law degree, so I always thought that if I get into that, that's where I want to go.
So once you did get a seat in Delhi University, what was your feeling? How was the whole course there? Was it a 3-year course? Did you decide what you wanted to specialize in? How was that whole experience?
So the experience was actually amazing. You get a lot of time to do a lot of internships, a lot of extracurriculars, whether it is mooting or writing papers. There's also some courses where the professors are just brilliant, and you would not want to miss those courses ever, and you'll be very lucky if you get to study from those professors. I was fortunate where I had a great time, both in terms of personally, where I made some really, really good long-lasting friendships, and also in terms of all the network that I was able to build in those 3 years. The time that it gave me to not only study but also focus on the practical side of law, which is very, very important, and that is working at different law firms, at different chambers, with different lawyers, and also writing as many papers, taking part in public speaking events. So I think that was something that law faculty gave me the flexibility to do, and it was also something that I really, really enjoyed doing.
And Ishmeet, one of the questions that we got from our community members was that, is it challenging to be a non-NLU graduate? Do you think that you were at a disadvantage?
Definitely. I think there is a bit of prejudice there. National law schools are brilliant, and they do offer a very, very good 5-year degree, and you can't really compare the two degrees. But at the same time, you can't also only think that national law schools are the best. It is difficult when you go into a law firm that usually recruits from national law schools directly to also give you, as a 3-year law degree student, the same sort of credibility and the same sort of opportunity. It is a bit tough out there, but it's not impossible. I have done it, and I know many of my friends who have done it too. National law schools offer a 5-year law degree, and that 5 years gives them enough time to figure out what area of law they want to get into and what they want to specialize in and where they want to work. In a 3-year law degree, by the time you actually settle, you have to leave. So that is a challenge. But the 3-year law degree also gives you tremendous flexibility. It also actually, and most importantly, enables you to meet people from different backgrounds. It really expands your network, and it's actually the network that really, really takes you a very long way, especially if you're not a second generation, third generation lawyer, and you're a first generation lawyer who's trying to start out and make a career.
So Ishmeet, you were 24 when you became a lawyer, right?
Yeah.
That's such a young age. What did you do after that? You've become a lawyer, you're excited to enter the job market. What was the next step that you took?
So I actually, in my final year of law degree, had done an internship with a senior judge of the Supreme Court. This internship I actually secured by cold calling the personal secretary of the judge, and I emailed him and I sent him my resume and I sent him a full cover letter as to why I would make a good legal intern to a judge. I was called for an interview and I subsequently secured a 6-week internship with the judge. I worked really hard those 6 weeks. I remember I would slog day and night, and whatever was required of me, I was always willing to do it. And that actually helped me get a clerkship, which is a 1-year contract where you get to work with a judge of the Supreme Court and you assist him in all that is required, from legal judgments to speeches to attending court proceedings and also understanding the different areas of law and assisting him in every aspect of legal knowledge that he may require.
So you actually went out of your way to find that internship for yourself. It wasn't that there was a campus placement or anything. You went and found it yourself, right?
No, it really isn't. And that's the thing about opportunities. They're not always going to present themselves to you. You always have to go and find them. And I remember speaking to a friend and telling her that I wanted to do a clerkship. She knew someone who was clerking with this judge, and she asked me to get in touch with him. I got in touch with him, got the email ID of the personal secretary of the judge, and I wrote to the personal secretary directly, sending my CV, sending my cover letter, and stating reasons as to why I would be a good legal intern or a clerk in the future.
Wow, wonderful. Working for a Supreme Court judge, was that intimidating?
So it was actually, Meher, but I was very lucky to have had a judge and a boss who was so brilliant and was more like a teacher than anything else. And that's so important to get a good first boss in your career, because that can really help you and want you to do better in the profession. And that's something I really credit my 1.5 years there.
So then what was the next step? What did you think at this point in your career? You know, you have this 1.5 years of experience working for a Supreme Court judge. You know the nitty-gritties of how it works. What was going through your mind now?
Yeah, I was very determined to get into litigation and go to court and fight someday and defend those who are in need of justice. I was very sure I wanted to do that. But I also wasn't sure whether I wanted to do that immediately or I wanted to pursue further studies. At that point of time, I spoke to a lot of people again, and I had friends who had also pursued the LLM, and the experience they had was amazing. And I thought I was ready to study a bit more. I wasn't sure whether I wanted to get into practice that soon, but I did know I wanted to study more and kind of understand certain aspects of the law before I can actually decide what I want to do for a lifetime.
So then you decided to pursue an LLM outside of India. How did you make that decision? Why pursue a master's in law outside of the country that you've just studied at?
So actually, the LLM is not a degree that teaches you the law of the country. It's a theoretical degree. It teaches you aspects of law. It teaches you jurisprudence of law. It teaches you the philosophy of law. So I applied both to the US and the UK. I wasn't sure where, but I was definitely sure not India. And it was more for the international exposure than anything else.
So then how did you decide between American schools and British schools?
So I actually applied to a lot of American schools, Ivy League schools, and UK schools. Before I heard from Cambridge, actually, I had an offer from Columbia University and I was sure I'm gonna do that. But I got the offer from Cambridge, and it was a hard one to refuse. It was also a course that was more to my liking and more where I wanted to be at that point in my life and in my career. I wasn't sure I was willing to shell out more money or pay more money to get a degree that was just for 1 year in the US, because it is double the price and it is the same duration. So it was definitely a factor I was considering. But Cambridge was definitely my first choice.
Wonderful. So many factors come into play when you're deciding to pursue a master's degree. But Ishmi, before we get into the nitty-gritties of your experience at Cambridge, I want to ask you, is it necessary for everyone to do an LLM, or is it okay to be just a law graduate and, you know, make your career out of that?
Absolutely. It's really not important to do an LLM at all. In fact, you should look at what is required from you in terms of where you want to be. So if you want to be abroad, an LLM will just open more doors for you, because those are recognized universities in that country. But if you're wanting to be in India or in your home country, wherever that may be, an LLM is nothing but just a personal and professional experience for yourself. It won't add that much of a difference back home. So actually, that was something I did feel when I did do an LLM and I came back. Except for the wow and oh my god, and a few gasps and awes, there wasn't anything much that I gained from.
So let's talk about your admission at Cambridge University. You got 100% scholarship to get into that course. How did you manage it? What was the name of that scholarship? And how can other aspiring students, you know, think about gaining a scholarship? What do they need to do to get a scholarship?
So yeah, I was very, very fortunate and very lucky to have been awarded a scholarship to study at Cambridge. I got awarded the Pratibha Singh and Cambridge Trust Scholarship. So you have to actually apply for the scholarship at the same time that you are applying for your master's degree. So the same application will have another page or another form which will require you to detail out why you deserve a scholarship, what scholarships you should want to apply for, what are the key things that separate you from other candidates, and you have to list out your most prized achievements and things that you're very, very proud of on those forms. And there is a bit of a lengthy process. There are interviews in place that actually then question you on all that you've written in your forms. But it is a great experience. And if you do actually end up getting admission, do try and look at different websites that offer scholarships, because there are many, many out there, private and university ones, that offer scholarships to master's students.
And how did you get to know about these websites? Are they easily available on public portals?
So depends from university to university. I was very fortunate. Cambridge actually had a page or web page where they had listed out all the scholarships that they offer. I also spoke to a lot of friends who were simultaneously applying for different scholarships. There are Commonwealth scholarships, there are scholarships for different subjects in particular. It is always good to really, really dig into the webpage of the university that you're applying to, see what your credentials are, what they want, and how you can bridge that gap and meet that gap. So it was very important for me to actually look at Cambridge website, see if there was any scholarship that spoke to me or any scholarship that I was eligible for. And I applied to a number of them, and the merit-based scholarships, they also need-based scholarships. So look at what the criteria are.
How many people in specific get that scholarship that you were awarded?
So every year it's different. Some years only one get, some year two or three people get. My year, we were three of us who got awarded that scholarship.
Wow, fantastic. Must have been such a proud moment, no?
It really was, and it was such a great function that was actually organized for the three awardees, where we had to speak about our experiences, our journey, and how we felt when we got awarded that scholarship.
So was this the proudest moment of your career?
I don't know if it was my proudest moment, but it was definitely my family's proudest moment. And just the look on their faces was very, very satisfying, especially after the board debacle of so many years ago.
Oh, funny. Okay, so why don't we talk about your experience at Cambridge, you know, moving to another country at such a young age, completely alien environment. The way of studying was, I'm sure, very, very different from what you had experienced before. So let's talk about your experience at Cambridge. How was that? How was the learning journey different for you?
Sure. It was actually a very, very different journey and experience, and nothing that I could have ever imagined. My year at Cambridge flew by. I took part in a lot of activities. I attended different events that the university was organizing. Definitely the academic structure and the way the subjects are taught is very, very different from what I was used to in Delhi University. I was used to more of a rote learning style, and also a style where I had to know the questions and answer the questions based on what the book is saying. Cambridge actually challenged that, and it challenged me a lot. It made me think out of the box. We were required to actually advance the law, not just speak the law. So we had to look at ways that the law would develop, not just what the law was. And that actually got me thinking a lot. It got me to think differently. It also got me to engage in class where I usually earlier never used to. And that was really encouraged, for you to speak up in class, for you to think differently. There was no right or wrong answer. And every answer was always the correct answer, actually, because you had to just come up with something that was different, that was unique, that was your own. And I think that was something that was such a great experience and such a unique experience for me.
So was it like a practical way of learning?
So not really, Mehar. It was actually a very, very theoretical, but very different. It challenged the way you thought. So there was a lot of readings, there was a lot of things to go through. The list of readings never ended. Not just read the text, but question everything that was written in the text and have your own understanding, have your own interpretation. And that was something that was highly encouraged in the university.
And what else did you learn at Cambridge? Did you network with different types of people, you know, working with people from all over the world? How was that for you?
Oh, it was such a great experience, Meghar. I think that was something for me that has been the most fulfilling experience, which was to meet people from all over the world. I hadn't done that before. I hadn't studied in a foreign university before. So I got to make friends from Serbia, from Russia, from Bulgaria, from different parts of the world. Parts of the world I didn't even know existed. And it was actually a very unique experience because it opens your mind to different cultures, different ways of thinking, and it also makes you a good team player where you can actually listen to other people and listen to different ideas and listen to different ways of thinking. And that's something I really credit Cambridge and any foreign university for that matter.
And then what did you do afterwards once you finished your LLM at Cambridge? What was the next step for you?
So I was sure I wanted to litigate in India, and I actually narrowed it down to commercial litigation, which is also an area of law I specialized in at Cambridge. I started looking at different law firms that would be open to hiring me. There are top law firms and there are different law firms and there are different ways of applying to them. Some is through the HR website, some is through actually directly writing to the partner, and sometimes it's also okay to speak to a former employer of yours and see if he can recommend you to a place where they are willing to hire you.
Wonderful. So going back to India from the UK and settling back in the work environment there, how was that change for you?
It was definitely a very, very challenging thing, but more than UK and India, it was the fact that from a student life, I was getting back to working life. And not only working at any other place, but I actually got to work at Amar Chand, which is a very, very challenging environment to be in. It's very competitive, but it's also a place where they really, really focus on you as a lawyer, developing your skills as a lawyer and trying to make you into a better lawyer every day.
So what did you do at Amar Chand?
So I actually worked in the disputes department, arbitration and litigation at Amar Chand. I used to go to court and I used to fight cases. As a junior lawyer, your work is restricted to research and drafting petitions, drafting applications, and that's what I mainly did while I was at Amar Chand.
And Ishmeet, here I want to touch upon some of the aspects of being like a female lawyer in India. Was it challenging? Did you have to face any hurdles? How was that for you?
So definitely, Meher. I mean, this is something I think about, and even, you know, till date, it's a topic that's close to me. I remember going into the court one day and looking down from the second floor, and it was a sea of men in black, because we wear a black robe in courts. And I remember thinking to myself that not only there's a dearth of women in professional careers, but there's a serious dearth of women in the legal profession. Partly that could be because the nature of the work is such that you're required to spend a lot of hours working, and it may not necessarily fit into a personal life and the work-life balance. Why probably a lot of women, at least earlier, did take up the profession, but there is a change. There is a wave that's come, and there are women out there, young women out there, who are not only looking at becoming fantastic lawyers, but who are also looking at going into different areas of professional life.
Wow, that sounds really challenging. But how did you manage as a woman? Like, you know, it is a profession, like you said, mostly that is taken up by men. So did you feel like the sore thumb? What did you say to yourself at that moment?
I remember at one point of time in my team of 6 or 7, I was the only woman. It was intimidating at times. There were certain jokes that I wasn't privy to or I wasn't made part of. But I remember telling myself that I'm here to learn, I'm here to become a better lawyer, and I'm here to be a better human being that can help fellow humans achieve justice, right some wrongs. So I guess I only focused more on the work aspect of it, but that's not to say that the gender aspect didn't always play in my mind. It did play in my mind, and it was always right in front of me because I was in court, which was full of men. I was in office where there were mostly men, but I always tried to focus on the work at hand. I tried to show that I wasn't just employed because I was a woman, or that women can't work as well as men, or any preconceived notions or biases. I try to dispel them. In fact, most of the times I try to not even think about it.
So the next phase for you was actually moving back to the UK. How did you manage to get a job in London sitting in New Delhi? How did that happen for you?
So I wanted to move to the UK for personal reasons, and I actually looked at different opportunities online and what was on offer, especially for arbitration lawyers sitting in India. There are a number of internship opportunities, there are a number of work placements where actually Indian lawyers are encouraged to apply. And I was very fortunate. I applied for one opportunity and they offered me the role. In fact, they also sponsored me. So you have to make sure that you look at all the offers that are there out there, all the opportunities that are there out there. There are so many law firms that are willing to hire Indian lawyers or lawyers that speak different languages. And you know, Neha, that is so important. When I came here, I realized that languages is a key asset. So if you can focus on maybe learning Spanish or maybe learning some other language while you are in your free time as a student, definitely consider doing that.
Yeah, it's definitely becoming like a global economy and we're all like global citizens. So, you know, you never know whatever skills you pick up could come handy.
Absolutely. And I never knew how important language skills were till the time I got here actually.
Yeah, wow. So what exactly do you do now? What is your role? What is your job?
So I'm a disputes lawyer at an American law firm in London. My job, to be very honest, is very similar to what I used to do in India. I do research and I do drafting. I work with the team of International Dispute Resolution Group lawyers. We are focusing a lot on investment arbitrations, commercial arbitrations, different types of arbitrations is what I would say I focus on. And that's also something I want to have a long-term career in, which is international arbitration, international disputes.
And what do you think is the difference in the work culture of working at a law firm in India versus working in a law firm in London? I'm sure it's as competitive, but what are one or two different things for you?
I think the two key different things for me was, first and foremost, they are very, very appreciative of your personal time. That's not to say that there is a lot of work and it does get into your personal time, but they really value personal space and any time that you make for your own family or your friends. There's a good work-life balance, especially in the UK. I think more so because they know that you have to do a lot of your personal work. So I think that's why they always encourage work-life balance. I think second important difference for me was diversity. In India, we're used to working with, of course, India is a diverse country and it's got different cultures within it, but the international diversity that I got to experience in the UK has been phenomenal because it doesn't make you feel out of place even one bit. To see that there are so many cultures and to see that you're working on international cases where everyone knows the same amount of law that you do, it actually turns out to be pretty beneficial and it's also a very, very challenging but very, very exciting opportunity.
Wow, so now you've been working here for like 6 to 8 months. What is next for you in your future?
I don't know, Mehar. I mean, to be very honest, my entire life I have tried to plan, but things never go as per your plan. But I would ideally like to work as an arbitration lawyer, focusing on international disputes, focusing on, you know, different areas of investment arbitrations, commercial arbitrations. So that's definitely where I see myself, but who knows where the future is heading.
Wonderful, wonderful. So Ishmi, before we wrap up, why don't you give us a few tips that you can give to young students who are watching this and also a few tips that you could give to your younger self?
Definitely. I think few tips for the younger students out there. If things don't go according to plan, don't worry. Take a deep breath, reassess all that you had thought of doing, all that you wanted to do. I think a very important thing, Neha, and I always keep telling this to other people who ask me, is see what you're good at and what you want to do and see if you can bridge the two. It's important to not just aspire towards something you want to do without seeing if you actually have the skills to do that. So it's important to see whether you have the skills, what are the skills required, and try and bridge the gap. I think another very important tip I would like to give young students out there is speak to people, network, reach out to mentors. Reach out to people who can help you guide. I wish there was someone out there for me who could actually tell me, you know, what I should do next or how I should chalk my life out or how I should plan my day or how I should plan my week. to have mentors out there who are willing to take out their time and who can actually tell you how you should plan your day, how you should plan your week, that will be the most productive and the most positive, I think is highly beneficial. And that's something I wish all you young students out there take the most advantage of. Key things to my younger self, I think I would tell myself that don't worry, things have a way of working out. If you've fallen down, always remember to pick yourself up, have a bad day, give yourself a day to feel bad, to recover from your loss, but always look at all the things that are ahead for you. You may have plans, but the universe has plans for you, and those plans are always better than anything that you could have ever imagined. And that's something I firmly believe in.
I love that. Just before we close this interview, Ishmeet, is there anything you wish you knew before you started your journey as a law student, as a lawyer?
I think I wish I had known that networking is a key part of succeeding, not just as a lawyer, but I think in any profession, but I think more so as a lawyer. I was very fortunate to have made some great friends at my university, at Delhi Faculty of Law, which actually helped me get so many internships. Just speaking to friends and friends of friends, half of the time I was just networking with fellow students, seniors, juniors. And I think it's really important as a young lawyer to be social, to try and meet new people, to try and get into as many activities as you can. Figure out what you're interested in. Are you interested in writing? Are you interested in speaking? There are a lot of extracurricular activities out there where you can take part in and which would suit one of your skills. So definitely look into those.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Ishmeet, for coming in and speaking to us. It's been such a pleasure talking to you and learning all about the fantastic things you've done.
Thank you, Meher. It was an absolute pleasure to speak to you. Thank you.
Great. If you find this video useful, please, please don't forget to share, like and subscribe to this channel. Make sure you comment down below with any questions that you have. I will make sure that Ishmeet answers and gets back to you. I'll be back soon with another one. But until then, keep hustling hard, keep faith and believe in the universe, and good things will happen for you. I hope to see you soon. Bye.